Ladies and gentlemen, to speak of India is to speak of a subcontinent, almost a continent. I do not have to say that today, one in every seven human beings on this planet is an Indian. But I would like to add that one in every eight natural languages, human languages, is an Indian language. The enormity of the number is quite mind-boggling. It is quite overwhelming. However, I would like to add that about 50 years back, of the world's entire linguistic stock, 16% were Indian languages. Today, of the entire world's language stock, 13% are Indian languages. While the population has gone up, the number of languages have correspondingly, comparatively, gone down. And that's a cause for worry for me, for the rest of my countrymen, and for the humanity. Indians, by and large, traditionally, have been trilingual people. In the villages, they spoke their languages and had some knowledge of the regional larger language, but also a much larger language in the past, such as Sanskrit, in medieval times, such as Persian, and in today's times, it is either Hindi or in some cases, even English. In the cities, they have the familiarity and the competence to use their regional language, plus Hindi, which is some kind of a semi-national language, as well as some English. If we were to look at the top 30 languages of the world in terms of numerical strength, 10 of them are Indian languages. I could name those, but I'll not waste your time in naming those languages. If we were to look at the top 4 languages of the world, 2, and mark my words, I'm saying 2, are languages of India. I'm including the English language as an Indian language in this list of 2. One is, of course, Hindi. But today, the number of Indians who have some access to the English language is the largest among the numbers of English language speaking or using nations all over the world. Given the linguistic complexity in the country, the makers of the Indian Constitution had a really challenging job in deciding what kind of policy should be followed, what kind of provisions be made in the Constitution of India when they sat down to draft the Constitution of India. They had many other challenges. It was not as if they were looking only at the language question. India had moved from the old order of princely states to becoming a new democracy. India had moved from a colonial state to a new kind of democratic free setup. And there was, of course, the question of enormously large number of landless and migratory people to take into account. So it is not as if the Constituent Assembly had only the language issue to focus on. And therefore, I shall not pass any unduly adverse comments on the achievements they made. India became independent in 1947, August 1947 to be precise, that independence came to India in the trail of a huge bloodshed because of the partition of the country. The Constituent Assembly met. It was formed a year before India officially got independence. That is, the Constituent Assembly was constituted, formed in 1946, and it worked for 4 years, 46, 47, 48, and 49. On 26 November 49, that's 2 days from now, so many years back, they finally firmed up the Constitution of India. From the second debate of the Constituent Assembly over that period of those 4 years, the first debate was to welcome the members. From the second debate to the last debate, in every debate, the question of language came up. And the question was as to in which language the debate should take place. It was agreed within the limited sphere of the Constituent Assembly, transactions of the Assembly, to have these debates either in Hindi or in English. And it was decided that the Constitution be drafted both in English and the Hindi language. On 26 November 49, the draft Constitution was finalized. 2 months later, on 26 January 1950, India became Republic, when it stated that we, the people of India, that is Bharat. India has two names, one in English, another in Hindi. The English name in English is India, the name in Hindi is Bharat. We, the people of India, that is Bharat, hereby adopt and give unto ourselves this constitution. On that day, 26 November, January 1950, the Hindi translation of the Indian constitution was still not ready. So we began in that linguistic frame. In the Constituent Assembly, when the debates on language, which language should be the language of administration, took place, the debates remained as expected without being concluded at all. All debates on all other issues that found some conclusion got translated into articles of the Constitution. But the language debate, which remained inconclusive, was translated in the form of a schedule of languages. So India did not decide on which was its national language or official language. This schedule of languages, which is the eight, there were several other issues that could not be decided on. And there are several such schedules to the Constitution of India. This is the eighth schedule of the Constitution, which listed 14 languages as the languages of administration. Some of those 14 were included for sentimental reasons. For instance, the Sanskrit language, because nobody in India now speaks the Sanskrit language, nobody understands it. But it had to be listed there purely for appeasing a populist sentiment and for projecting India's personality as a traditional society with long heritage. In the Constitution, there is one article, though, which speaks about language. And that article, which is Article 347, reads, on a demand made in that behalf, the President may, if he is satisfied that a substantial proportion of the population of the state desire the use of any language spoken by them to be recognized by that state, may direct that such language shall also be officially recognized throughout that state or any part thereof for such purposes as he may specify. This article allowed the Indian states to add to this list of 14 languages given in the 8th schedule, we call them the scheduled languages. This Article 347 empowered the states to add to those 14 languages any other languages as and when they thought that addition, such addition, was desirable, necessary, or politically useful. The problem that the makers of the Indian Constitution faced while deciding on the language issue was paucity of reliable data. Prior to the making of the Indian Constitution, no clear or good survey of Indian languages was carried out. There was one survey which was undertaken by the Linguistic Survey of India office set up by the British towards the end of the 19th century, headed by an Irish linguist, George Abraham Grierson. The Grierson survey took nearly 28 years for its completion and covered practically the entire map of India, entire Indian subcontinent. However, when India became independent, the map of India was different, and therefore the Grierson survey did not really provide a completely useful data for considering the linguistic situation in the new India as the map was different. Grierson had not been able to cover the languages in southern India, and many of the languages covered by Grierson did not fall within the compass of the new India. Grierson had come up with a list of 179 languages and 544 dialects. It is not clear if all those that he described as dialects were really dialects, because there's a lot of debate about his conclusions. But in the census of 1921, that is still before India became independent, but a little after Grierson had started floating these figures of 179 languages, the census of 1921, there's a mention of 188 languages. So the makers of Indian Constitution had to proceed with these figures of 188 languages and 544 language-like dialects or dialect-like languages. And they came down to this list of 14 languages. Subsequently, after independence, three more languages were added to that list, bringing the list up to a figure of 17. And then another five languages were added more recently. Now it has got 22 languages in that list. In 1956, the question of administration started facing the Indian, the newly independent India, and as to how the administrative districts be drawn up. And so it was decided to do the geographical, the territorial reorganization of the country along linguistic lines. And a linguistic state reorganization commission was set up in 1954. The government of India at that time wanted to follow a model that they thought could be drawn from the USSR. However, there were a number of popular language movements, and therefore it was in terms of those, in response to those popular language movements, that linguistic states were created. I should add here, as some kind of side note, not a footnote, but a side note, additional information. Many of the modern Indian languages have their origin in a time which is about 1,000 years or 1,200 years before our time. And since then, languages like Bengali, Telugu, Tamil, Punjabi, Gujarati, Marathi, Malayalam, and so on have developed a very rich wealth of literary works, including epics, very rich wealth of grammatical works, dictionaries, prose, writing, scripts, and so on. And therefore, it was these languages that had a very clear literary history, that had a very good view between the social force and the language zones. They were the ones asking for linguistic states. So between 1956 and 1965, linguistic states were created in India. 17 of India's, at the moment India's 30 states, Indian territories divided in 30 states, 4 or 5 union territories, but the state is a larger unit than union territory. Union territories are very small geographical units, states are relatively larger units within India. Of these 13 states today, 18 are linguistically carved out states. So language has been the spine of the geographical distribution of India, and more than the constitution, it is this linguistic zoning, not in the bad sense but in the right sense, that has supported the upkeep of Indian languages. I mentioned that in 1921, the census of India had 188 languages. When we come to 1961 census, that is when the linguistic states were being created, a layer of language speakers, which was sub-regional, became extremely active. And in the census, 1961 census, when the count of mother tongues was presented to the nation, it had, and you know, hold your breath, it had names of 1,652 mother tongues. This is in the background was the making of linguistic states, and speaker of every variety of every language was looking for a greater say in the administration. When this tendency was noticed by the government of India, and 10 years later, when the next census was carried out in 1971, this number of mother tongue labels, I shall not use the term mother tongue languages, mother tongue, because these are self-proclaimed. The number of mother tongue labels was brought down by the government of India, by the census authorities, to 108. 1652 to 108. 1500, more than 1500 names of mother tongues were wiped out from the census reports of 1971. There was, of course, a context to this, and that is, our census data is disclosed about 6 or 7 years after the census exercise is carried out. The census exercise is carried out in the first year of a decade. The census data comes up, is disclosed, is announced in the year 6 or 7 of that decade. In 73 or 72 perhaps, Bangladesh became an independent country. Through a war with Pakistan, predominantly on language issue. And so the Indian government became very worried, very scared of a linguistic balkanization of the country. And hence, they adopted a principle of not disclosing the figures of those languages, names of those languages, which had less than 10,000 speakers. So this 108 figure of 1971 census is of those languages which had more than 10,000 speakers. At the moment, in the last census data that is known to us, that is of 2001. The 2011 data is still not disclosed for public consumption, though one can have access to it. This figure stands at 122. Now, given this complexity of languages and the large number of languages, it is really very difficult to decide on any single language's language of administration. So different states are allowed to use different languages as languages of administration. In the parliament, the debates are conducted theoretically in 22 languages, practically in one language, that is the Hindi language. But the records are kept first in the English language, then in Hindi, and then in what we, as we call them, regional languages, the other languages. Higher education in the country is entirely for the purpose of technical subjects, such as engineering and medicine, exclusively in English. But theoretically, it is available in all Indian languages that one wants to use. It was in 1835, way back in the 19th century, that Lord Macaulay had said that all education in India, higher education, should be in English. In 1885, when the University of London formulated its syllabus for the English language study, Indian universities at Madras, Bombay, Calcutta accepted that syllabus. There have been many reforms in that, the curriculum reforms have taken place, yet the language for higher education remains predominantly, and in more lucrative fields, the English language. We have about 1,000 television channels in the country. Of these, 80 are in English, 920 are in Indian languages, other Indian languages. We have about 35,000 newspapers and magazines. Of these 35,000 newspapers and magazines, about 1,200 are in English and others are in Indian languages. Published books, we have an excellent publishing industry in major Indian languages, and the sales of books in those languages is normally higher. To give you an example, a personal example, a book I wrote in 1992 got a national award. It was counted as the best book in the English language. Since its publication, it has sold 6,000 copies. It is translated in 8 Indian languages, and together they have done about 200,000 copies business. A book written in English. So it's a mixed picture. Now I will go to the languages that are not recognized as state languages, that are not used in schools and universities. And these languages, for the sake of convenience, I name as indigenous languages. When I say these are indigenous languages, not all of them were born in India. Some of them have come from Africa. For instance, the Sindhi language has come from Africa. Some have come from Australia. Some others have come from other countries. Incidentally, there are 146 languages that India shares with its neighboring countries. And there has been a lot of coming and going of these languages. Karen language has come to India from Myanmar, from China, so many languages have come, from Afghanistan, so many languages have come, and so on. Sri Lanka, they have come. So not all indigenous languages are indigenous languages. But I am using this caption for the sake of convenience of this discourse. India has about 8% of Indian population is the population of indigenous people. Fortunately, in India, they are still not exterminated. they still can live. At least they are half alive, if not fully alive. They are half alive. They are allowed to survive. India has about 60 million nomadic communities. Some of them are long distance. Some of them have come all the way to Hungary and Romania, such as the Banjaras, who speak the gypsy languages. The nomadic communities have 190 communities and about 105 languages shared between them. Of these 105 languages of the nomadic communities, nearly 60 odd languages are code languages. That is, they are full-fledged languages within themselves. But these languages, the communities are extremely hesitant to use them in the presence of any third person. And therefore, they've been secretive about these languages. I tried to document these, and I did a comprehensive linguistic survey of India in the last decade or so. And the total number of living languages that has cropped up in my survey, I did not do it alone. I had a team of 3,000 volunteers. I was the chief postman in that, you know, sir. 870 languages, the total number, living languages, 870 languages. But in comparison to 1961 census, I noticed that about 250 languages had died in the last 50 years. That's a large number. 250 languages is not a joke. I was speaking of the nomadic communities. They have their languages, and the indigenous people, there are about 450 odd indigenous communities, the tribal communities. And they have between them nearly 200 odd languages. Now, many of these languages are developing scripts. Many of them have started publishing literature. Some of them, very few of them, but some, those few, are also recognized as languages of states. In Mega, there's a small state called Meghalaya in the northeast. It uses two of the tribal languages, Khasi and Garo. There is another state called Mizoram, which uses a tribal language called Mizo as the state language. There is a third state called Tripura, which uses yet another tribal language called Kokbarak as its state language. So some of the indigenous languages have come to the status of being state languages. Some have come to the status of having scripts of their own. Some have come to the status of having scripts as well as literature of their own. But a majority of them are breathing their last breath. I will not at all be surprised, though I'll be greatly shocked and saddened, when I see that in the next 50 years, nearly 300 of Indian languages will be washed out. Not a trace of those languages will remain there. I will conclude what I had to say. The Constitution of India has been very generous, allowing 22 languages. All official institutions springing out of the Constitution, have been generous. The National Literary Academy promotes and protects 26 languages. The National Book Trust promotes and protects nearly 30 languages. The University Grants Commission runs colleges and universities in nearly 35 languages. Last year, I was asked by the University Grants Commission to set up 21 new centers for research in indigenous languages. Despite this generosity, despite this large vision of linguistic complexity, the Constitution and the regulations and the patronage and the support in the public space are just not enough to keep the Indian languages going. Most of them are likely to perish in the next half century or 30 years or 40 years or 50 years. I am now engaged in doing an exact status report for each and every language in India. having completed my linguistic survey, and it is a cause for worry for us. If every language is a unique worldview, then only 4% of the worldviews of India were ever reflected in the Parliament of India. 96% of Indian worldviews were never reflected in the Parliament of India. Some years back, one language, like, you know, 85 year old is the youngest speaker, you said. One language in the Andamans died, ended. The last speaker was 85 year old. And in the last days of her life, she was speaking only to birds because there was nobody else to speak to. And her language had a clear lineage of 65,000 years. Because Andaman is that area where no external, you know, incursion ever took place. Many languages which are spoken by 4 or 5 or 10 or 100 or 1,000 are rapidly disappearing. Therefore, it is not the constitution which, despite its being very generous, that will protect our languages. It is the interest of the citizens and interest of the rest of the world that will protect our languages, because every Indian language is not just the heritage of Indian people, it is also the heritage of the world. And that India has more than 10%, 13% of languages of the world, requires all of us to look at India as a hotspot of language decline and as a rapidly growing graveyard of languages. Thank you.